Before, Julia, we get into the nuts and bolts of the market performance, Rio Tinto, just in the last 10 minutes, coming out with their first half report card. Underlying earnings, $4.2 billion, pretty much in line with forecasts.
We have seen the headline number coming in line with expectations, coming in at $4.229 billion, and the consensus stood at $4.231 billion. So it's nice to see that they have come in line with expectations. We break it down, though, if we have a look at it division by division. Our iron ore was actually slightly below expectations. The consensus was at $4.51 billion. It's actually coming at $4.27 billion, so that was slightly weaker, but that was made up by a higher-than-expected result coming through from aluminium, which was actually at $123 million, compared to an expected fall of $44 million. We also saw copper coming in on expectations pretty much, $348 million there. The consensus stood at $347 million, so you couldn't get much closer. And then energy, we saw a loss of $52 million there. That was worse than expected. The market was expecting to see a loss of $27 million. And the real kicker came in the other divisions department, where we only saw a loss of $67 million, and it was expected that we'd see a loss of about $280 million there. So the numbers really just dropping in the last 10 minutes, a lot to absorb there. Yeah. I guess one of the things that the market's watching very closely is that dividend payment. No surprises here, 83.5 cents. And of course, Rio Tinto has this policy where it pays around about 50% of the last year's full year dividend, and we've seen that certainly come through. Some of the things that we'll be watching in the webcast, which is around about 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, is really how the sale of the assets are going at the moment. We know that there's three top priorities for Rio Tinto, and they've really outlined this, and that's to improve the performance. It's about $1.5 billion of total cost outs at the moment, and I think they're aiming for about $5 billion. But secondly, to improve the balance sheet. So we are going to be watching where they are stopping spending, and looks like Oyu Tolgoi Phase 2 will be put on hold there. And thirdly, just having a look at some of the results coming through. And of course, they are still looking at that Pilbara project, aiming to ramp up to 290 million tonnes per annum. But we will also be watching on how the sale of some of their assets are progressing. We've now seen the sale of North Parks, and of course we want to see the sale of the Iron Ore Company of Canada. That's expected to bring in more than $3 billion, as well as the sale of the Australian coal assets, which is expected to bring in about $2 billion. So I think that's going to be the key to that webcast, which is at 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. All in all, the Rio Tinto numbers coming in on expectations. The iron ore number, though, a little bit softer than consensus.
That's the case. The growth stocks, I mean, they're going to be the beneficiaries, aren't they?
We've already seen the material sector running pretty well over the month of July, so we have seen, I guess, a little bit more weighting in terms of the material space, given that we have seen iron ore prices holding up fairly well. We have a look at the China impact. It does have a big impact in terms of materials, but also in terms of the Australian economy. The Australian economy is probably the most exposed to the China growth story out of all the Western economies. It makes up about 30%, 35% of our exports and about 6% of our GDP, and that's really why these China numbers are important for the Australian economy, but also for the Australian share market, really impacting on the second largest sector on our market, which is the material space. So just watching the China numbers very carefully, and over the last couple of weeks, we've heard some good news coming out of China. We've seen the liquidity crunch, the conditions there really easing, but also the Chinese government coming out with some supportive measures. And they're things like abolishing temporary some small business taxes to help stimulate that part of the economy, and also some infrastructure spend in the way of roads. So that's been taken positively by the market as well.
We're going to talk a little bit more detail about Rio's numbers later in the show with David Lennox, a resources analyst over at Fat Profits. I wanted to move on to one of the other big corporate stories today, Julia, and that would be Telstra. Stock performance was fantastic, up 2.4% today. The numbers look good, particularly headline and drilling down into the detail.
The headline numbers, they beat on expectation. I guess the big one we were watching with Telstra was any clues around the dividend, but it did stay at $0.14 as expected. But Telstra saying that one of its long-term goals is to grow the dividend. And of course, that's what shareholders really want to hear. They do have an $11 billion payment dropping because of the NBN. And that should increase the capacity for Telstra to be able to pay a higher dividend. In terms of the forecast going forward, though, predicting lower growth rates, so predicting low single-digit growth rates, and in terms of free cash flow, predicting $4.6 billion to $5.1 billion worth of free cash flow in the current financial year. Now, that's below their last year's predictions for the last financial year, which was between $4.75 to $5.25 billion, with Telstra coming right in the middle at $5 billion. So just watching that free cash flow number, because that also dictates how freely they can increase their dividends as well. But all up, the headline number coming in ahead of expectations, some very strong mobile subscriber growth. We know that their media area has been coming under pressure because of Yellow Pages, so that wasn't a huge surprise. And their fixed line business also coming under pressure, but no huge surprises there either.
Julia, the Telstra result I thought was absolutely fantastic, and I think the bit that I liked most was the mobiles piece. Mm. I mean, they broke through 50.7% market share. We didn't expect to see that until sometime next year. That's an amazing result, and really does change the way you have to look at Telstra from just being a pure dividend play to actually having a significant growth business. Does that change the assessment of Telstra?
Absolutely. I mean, the last couple of years, we have seen strong growth in the mobile segment of Telstra, and really, I think this has been helped along by the problems that we've seen from Vodafone. Those problems are now largely over, so that real kicker that Telstra has received over the last couple of years because of the problems in Vodafone and a lot of their mobile subscribers are transferring over to other mobile carriers like Telstra, I think that key effect is over. Now it's all about increasing the data that they're selling, and I think this is the next key area. Really, the data, the 4G network means that things are moving faster, you can be on longer and using more data, and that's the key area of growth that they're watching. It was also quite impressive, their international business. We saw a growth of about 16% there. So while the Australian business saw some strong growth numbers, 1.3 million new customers, we also saw some strong numbers in their international business. But I think here domestically, the challenge now is going to be to continue that growth, because the kicker from Vodafone, I think, is largely over.